of you. We'll try that again. Good morning. How are you folks today? Brave that terrible winter weather? We have a number of announcements in our bulletin today that you will take the time to look at, right? Nobody agreed on that one, Pastor. I hear rumors of something going on that pretty soon we're supposed to be hearing about a Christmas banquet. And I don't think that's in the bulletin, is it? Is it in there? Oh, there we go. Save the date. Save the date. Down here. So save the date. I'm not going to tell you what it is. I want you to look at it. And I've heard a rumor of some multilinguistic serenaders that are going to sing some stuff for us in different languages. So that alone is going to be worth the $100 you're going to pay for the deal. I don't know. I don't think it's $100. Operation Christmas Child is probably even the more important thing for us to remember. And please do be thinking about that. There will not be a White Cross ministry meeting this Tuesday. There will not be a White Cross ministry meeting, okay? So if you're on automatic pilot, turn it off. This week there's no White Cross. I think there will be the following week. Okay? I don't think they're here yet. Just a heads up, there should be 3 younger people coming to join us for worship today that are totally new, and 2 of them are totally new to me. So please greet them warmly and get to know who they are. I only know the name of one, and that's Logan. Okay. Today we're going to be singing an interesting package of music. Some of you will recall the songs, some of you won't, but it's going to be a fun time because it actually spans a history of at least 1 century of Christian music. We often don't realize the heritage we have in Christian music, but our psalm today will talk a little bit about that. So the one song that we're going to start out with today, before we get into the actual invocation and welcome to worship reading, it starts with Michael W. Smith's song from 1981, and that's the most recent song that we're going to be singing today. For a lot of us, that's before we even knew what Christianity was. That's 41 years ago. There are other songs. One other song has no author. We don't even know who wrote it, and it's not the Bible that wrote it. We have one dated by an author who was the founder of the Christian Missionary Alliance Church, A.B. Simpson, from way back, probably before the year 1900, because he died in 1919. He was a prolific writer of hymns, and that's one of them. And then in the middle, from the era of many of us when we were learning about contemporary music, we know the name of John W. Peterson. Remember that guy, some of you? And this song was written the year I was born. So we're spanning stuff from way back to not so recent even with Michael W. Smith, whom we all know already. The psalm that we want to start with today is Psalm 33, verses 1 to 5. And I think it's important for us to heed the words of the song because too often churches have struggled over whether we should be singing old songs, new songs, middle songs, whatever songs, and whether the rhythm should be with a drum, with a guitar, with a piano, whether nothing. Some churches don't even use instruments. Okay? So let's listen to this psalm together. Sing joyfully to the Lord, you righteous. It is fitting for the upright to praise him. Praise the Lord with the harp. Make music to him with the 10-string lyre. Boy, I'd love to have one of those here. Sing to him a new song. Play skillfully, as Jonathan and Miranda do, and Darren on the drums, and Ardith on the organ today. For the word of the Lord is right and true. He is faithful in all he does. The Lord loves righteousness and justice. The earth is full of his unfailing love. Sing joyfully to the Lord, you righteous. We're not righteous because of our own righteousness. We're righteous because Christ is righteous. And it is because he lives within us by his Spirit that we can claim to be those righteous ones this psalm talks about. Let's pray. Father, we come before you this morning. We praise your name because you are worthy of praise. And really no one else is worthy of praise. We honor you. We want to glorify you. We want to worship you. And yet we confess we're not really quite sure what that means. But we know that you have said you inhabit the praise and the worship of your people. And we ask you that you would do so by your Spirit. Touch our hearts by your presence. We don't ask you to come. We don't ask you to show up because you are here. We ask simply, Lord, that you would attune our spirits to be able to connect more fully with your Spirit and sense your presence, sense your speaking in our hearts, in our ears, in our minds, in our emotions. You created us with 5 senses, Lord. May they all tune up to be able to sense what you have to say, what you're doing in our lives, and to sense your approval because you love us. You approve of us because we're your children. And you're proud of us. Thank you. In Jesus' name, amen.
I'm on. Yep. Unfortunately, I remembered what button I pushed. I shouldn't have pushed. So I did not do that for the purpose of illustration. What I was going to say is if you've ever been in a practice here, you will come away with such a fantastic appreciation for the people that sit up there that you never see. And this illustrates. If I push the wrong button here, you don't hear me. And that screws everything up. So thank you so much, team. And Joy has put up with such a frustration with me this week. She probably even cried. Just a little bit, she said. So let's sing together, How Majestic Is Your Name. Why don't we stand? Step back a few years on this next one. Let's talk about Jesus, the King of Kings is He, the Lord of Lords supreme throughout eternity.
is wonderful, Jesus my Lord. He is the mighty King, Master of everything. His name is wonderful, Jesus my Lord. He's the great shepherd, the rock of all ages. Almighty God is he. Bow down before him, love and adore him. His name is wonderful, Jesus my Lord.
Just keep trusting my Lord as I walk along. I just keep trusting my Lord, and he gives a song. Whether the storm clouds dark in the sky or the heavenly trail, I just keep trusting my Lord, he will never fail.
Such a faithful friend.
I can count on him.
I can count on him
to the very end. Though the storm clouds darken the sky or the heavenly trail, I just keep trusting my Lord. He will never fail. My Lord knows the way through the wilderness. My Lord knows the way through the wilderness. All I have to do is follow. Strength for today is mine all the way, and all that I need for tomorrow. My Lord knows the way through the wilderness. All I have to do is follow. Every day with Jesus is sweeter than the day before. Every day with Jesus, I love him more and more. Jesus saves and keeps me, and he's the one I'm waiting for. Every day with Jesus is sweeter than the day before. God so loved the world, he gave his only Son to die on Calvary's tree, from sin to set us free. Someday he's coming back, what glory that will be. Wonderful his love to me.
And here's the oldie.
Yesterday, today, forever, Jesus is the same. All may change, but Jesus never. Glory to his name. Glory to his name. Glory to his name. All may change, but Jesus never. Glory to his name.
And isn't he wonderful?
Isn't he wonderful, wonderful, wonderful? Isn't Jesus my Lord wonderful? Eyes have seen, ears have heard, he's recorded in God's word. Isn't Jesus my Lord wonderful?
Do it again.
Isn't he wonderful, wonderful, wonderful? Isn't Jesus my Lord wonderful? Eyes have seen, ears have heard, he's recorded in God's word. Isn't Jesus my Lord wonderful?
Pastor, you're going to preach an interesting sermon today. And I looked at the title, If You Should Suffer. You know, a lot of these songs say an awful lot about that journey. Thank you. You may be seated.
you have your Bibles with you, would you open them to the book of Proverbs? If you're using the blue Bible located in the pew in front of you, you will find our passage begins on page 639. The Word of God. A generous person will prosper. Whoever refreshes others will be refreshed. People curse the one who hoards grain, but they pray God's blessing on the one who is willing to sell. Whoever seeks good finds favor, but evil comes to one who searches for it. Those who trust in their riches will fall, but the righteous will thrive like a green leaf. Whoever brings ruin on their family will inherit only wind, and the fool will be servant to the wise. The fruit of the righteous is a tree of life, and the one who is wise saves lives. If the righteous receive their due on earth, how much more the ungodly and the sinner? So far, God's reading, or the reading of God's word. Let's pray together today. Let's offer our prayers of supplication and intercession for our brothers and sisters at home and around the world. Our sister church today is Sturgeon Valley up in St. Albert. Tom Anders is the pastor up there and leads an entire staff. We'll be praying for Tom and his wife, Lori, today. They have children, but we're just going to focus on Tom and Lori as kind of the leadership of that church. Mona also is, she's married. She has a husband named Gene and has two older children, older than Misa, but we only met really Misa, Mercy, and Francine, if you remember those kids from DVBS even 6 years ago. They're getting so big. Let's pray. Father, your word encourages us, if not commands us, to offer to you prayers of intercession and supplication on behalf of ourselves and others. And in this moment, as we pray, we do so intentionally, specifically for Paul and Tanya. Whatever it is they're doing while they're at home right now, the reports they have to give, the churches they have to visit, the functions they attend, Lord, give them energy, give them strength, help them to be refreshed and renewed. When I watch your servants come home on furlough from the mission field, they seem to be so busy and so frenetic that it probably feels like a rest for them when they go home. Lord, help us to be better as churches at supporting our missionaries so that they wouldn't have to travel to so many different places, give so many different reports, that they would actually be able to rest and find rejuvenation. May your hand of blessing rest upon Paul and Tanya. Lord, we lift up Tom and Lori and Sturgeon Valley before you and ask your anointing over the leadership of that church, the congregation, the community. We pray that you would use Sturgeon Valley Baptist Church to be a lighthouse to that great town, that there would be many people who would come to know Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior through the ministry of that church, that it would be a place where people could go and find you. I pray that you would encourage and strengthen the leadership in all of its capacities, and I pray a special anointing over Tom even this morning as he brings your word to your people. Lord, our family of the week, Mona and her whole family, we ask your anointing over her and grant her great wisdom as she reflects the light and the love of the Lord Jesus to others. And God, I'm just so grateful that you've given us an opportunity to get to know Mona and her kids and pray all the more in the days to come. We thank you for the witness that she's been and for the very fact that we can celebrate Sunday by Sunday with her sister, Abiba, and just so grateful for the way that you work and for the people that you bring into our midst. Lord, may your anointing and blessing rest over her. Father, I pray for this congregation, many of whom are struggling with illnesses, whether of a minor variety or sort, or even diseases which are of concern and cause at times for worry. And yet in your word you tell us not to worry, that you hold our days in your hand, that you are in control of all things. And yet when we're sick, we feel out of control. So help us to have a confidence in you, not trusting or relying in anything but your saving sovereign grace. Lord, we are grateful for doctors and medical staff and the people and the provisions you give us to treat us. But ultimately, we know that even by their hand, we are healed by you. And so we thank you for the doctors, the nurses, the hospitals, and all the people that work in them. We do confess that you are our hope. And it is you who ultimately decides who lives and who dies, and when they die. Lord, we commit ourselves into your loving care and pray for dignity and strength and courage for those who are suffering today in our own families, among our neighbors, our friends, even as we reflect on the horrible car accidents in Spruce Grove and Olds and all over the place. Pray for families who are grieving tragic losses over the past week. The horrible things that we can do to each other, Lord. Pray that somehow you can save and redeem even in the midst of the darkness and the trials. Lord, give comfort to those who mourn. Give us wisdom to know how to relate to those who are in a state of suffering even today. As we prepare this week to commemorate the surrender of German forces in 1918, we acknowledge the horrors of war, and we remember so that perhaps we can avoid more in the future. And yet it seems we are incapable of that. Lord, for all who are suffering in Eastern Europe today, be their strength and their comfort and their peace. For those who are separated from loved ones, the distance of countries and oceans, bring comfort and peace. In the midst of our suffering, help us to see the fruit and help us to be grateful for all that you have provided. For should we accept good from the Lord and not bad? But in all things you are proved righteous and you are just. And so I would humbly ask that you would search our hearts and know us, that you would forgive us of our sin. Grant us wisdom that we would repent of that which we need to repent of, and that we would fall before you and receive mercy from you, a gracious and compassionate God. Lord, be merciful to us and grant us wisdom that we might walk in your ways and live the lives you have called us to live. For your great name's sake and for your glory, we offer this prayer now. In Jesus' name, amen. I don't have an order of service before me. Is this the Operation Christmas Child video? Is that where we're at? Missions moment. We have been focusing and emphasizing Operation Christmas Child. Thank you so much. Next Sunday is our collection Sunday. So you have one more week to go to the dollar store or wherever and fill some shoe boxes. This is the fourth church that we've been a part of. And while we have endeavored to collect shoe boxes, I have to say, of the four churches we've been part of, this has not been our greatest effort, not even in the last 6 years. Donelda's been leading us and encouraging us to gather shoe boxes, and hopefully through these videos you see the power and the impact of this ministry, and I truly hope you'll be inspired to make the effort, even if you haven't already, to go out this week and just do a little bit of shopping, put together something that'll be a blessing to a child and create an opportunity in which they might hear the gospel and come to know the Lord. Could you show us that video, Brian?
Miss Child Shoebox Gifts. After receiving shoeboxes, children are invited back to the local church to participate in the Greatest Journey Discipleship Program. This is a follow-up program to the Shoebox Outreach events, and it's one of the world's largest discipleship programs. Since 2009, more than 1.5 million teachers have been trained to share the gospel in a clear, child-friendly way. So far, over 30 million children have participated in the Greatest Journey lessons, and more than 15 million children have given their lives to Jesus. That means that approximately 1 in 2 children participated in the Greatest Journey have given their lives to Jesus. And the multiplication continues as more than 16 million children have committed to pray and share their new faith with their family and friends.
Today's New Testament reading is from 1 Peter chapter 4, verses 12 through 19, and you can find that on page 1223 of the Blue Bible in front of you. Dear friends, do not be surprised at the fiery ordeal that has come on you to test you, as though something strange were happening to you. But rejoice inasmuch as you participate in the sufferings of Christ, so that you may be overjoyed when his glory is revealed. If you are insulted because of the name of Christ, you are blessed, for the Spirit of glory and of God rests on you. If you suffer, it should not be as a murderer or thief or any other kind of criminal or even as a meddler. However, if you suffer as a Christian, do not be ashamed, but praise God that you bear that name. For it is time for judgment to begin with God's household, and if it begins with us, what will the outcome be for those who do not obey the gospel of God? And if it is hard for the righteous to be saved, what will become of the ungodly and the sinner? So then, those who suffer according to God's will should submit themselves to their Creator, to their faithful Creator, and continue to do good. So far, the reading of God's word.
On Friday, we will pause and reflect on what we have as a nation. And what we have as a nation did not come without a cost. And do we have access to the Words for O Canada, Joy? Is it at the top of the service? You didn't find it up there, did you? Would you stand with me, and could we just sing O Canada? A cappella? Not to make Miranda panic. Let's sing. O Canada, our home and native land. True patriot love in all our sons command. With glowing hearts we see thee rise, the true North strong and free. From far and wide, O Canada, we stand on guard for thee. God keep our land glorious and free. O Canada, we stand on guard for thee. O Canada, we stand on guard for thee. There's a second verse. No? This is where I was really hoping we could go. Please let it work. I echo Dale's sentiments. Leith Anderson once said, demons no longer possess people and pigs, they possess photocopiers and PA systems. If it's not there, we'll just skip it, Joy. Please sit down. The second verse extols God's sovereignty and dominion over this land, and sometimes I think we get confused about just our own nobility and our own power, and I would say even to our own detriment. Just appreciated so much the lessons that we learned today in Sunday school over the fact that what God is concerned about is his name. What God is concerned about is keeping his covenant with Abraham. What God is concerned about is ultimately his glory. And sometimes I think we get the cart before the horse. I think sometimes we invert the paradigm, as somebody once said, that we somehow seem to think that God is some sort of lackey deity that was sent here to, in the person of Jesus, God incarnate, God made flesh, to serve us. That he is some sort of employee of ours that's, you know, come to do our bidding. We need some good weather. God, I'm going golfing. I need some good weather. God, I'm going to the mall. Get me a parking spot. God, I'm going to the dentist. Make sure I don't feel any pain. God, make my life easy. Make my life peaceful. Make sure that I never, ever suffer. Who likes to suffer? I don't like to suffer. I'm anti-suffering. You know what? It's part of life. It's an inevitability. It is one of the few things that we all have in common. When I was considering the message for today and just even thinking about, you know, on the 11th month, the 11th day, the 11th hour, we stop for a whopping total of 1 minute to think about the millions and millions and millions of people who died to provide for us the life we enjoy. And so if there's any fault with these statistics, I want to blame the fount of all knowledge, Wikipedia, but quoting directly from the internet, I know that's always dangerous, but here it is. The total number of military and civilian casualties in World War I was about 40 million. Estimates range from about 15 to 22 million deaths and about 23 million wounded military personnel, ranking it among the deadliest conflicts in human history. The total number of deaths include from 9 to 11 million military personnel. The civilian death toll was about 6 to 13 million. The Triple Entente, also known as the Allies, lost about 6 million military personnel, while the Central Powers lost about 4 million. At least 2 million died from diseases, and 6 million went missing, presumed dead. World War I. World War II was the deadliest military conflict in history. An estimated total of 70 to 85 million people perished, or about 3% of the 2.3 billion estimated people on Earth in 1940. Deaths directly caused by the war, including military and civilian fatalities, are estimated at 50 to 56 million, with an additional estimated 19 to 28 million deaths from war-related disease and famine. And this is what just struck me. Civilian deaths totaled 50 to 55 million. Civilian, not soldiers. People who got up to go get bread one morning and never came home. Military deaths from all causes totaled 21 to 25 million, including deaths in captivity of about 5 million prisoners of war. More than half the total number of casualties are accounted for by the dead of the Republic of China and the Soviet Union. I watched a documentary once that estimated 27 million Soviets died. 27 million. And I would be happily corrected on this, but I think the death toll for the United States was somewhere around 600,000. Now, if you watch movies, you can get the impression that the United States was the only country in that war. Soviet Union lost 27 million people. You know, it's been said no one wins a war. And I think it's impossible to estimate the ripple effect of these losses. I mean, somebody's dad doesn't come home. I mean, how's the family going to eat? What's going to happen to mom? What's going to happen to the children? What's going to happen to the soldiers' parents as they grieve their children? You know, that whole movie Saving Private Ryan was based on the fact that one mother had all of her sons on one boat that went down to the bottom of the deep blue sea. Wasn't that it? Didn't the ship sink? Or were they killed on the battlefield? Regardless, all of her kids, all of her sons, dead in one day. You know, what's that like? And can we even wrap our heads around it? You know, when you take preaching courses now, you know what they tell you not to do? One of the things that you should not do is quote historical data from anything before 1980, because today's generation just doesn't compute. They just can't relate. It's irrelevant information to them. They have no point of reference. They just can't fathom it. But I was born in 1968 in the great town of Salmonarm, British Columbia, which was resolutely patriotic, and where we sang God Save the Queen every morning, and where we sang O Canada, and the lyrics of that song are ingrained in my head, and to this day I haven't been able to make the adjustments of the Liberal government. Probably shouldn't say more about that at this time. You know, nothing draws out suffering like war. That's just truth. That's just a reality. But it's not to say that people don't suffer. You know, I talk to people every day who suffer. I talked to somebody last week who's got a relative who was, he and his wife were murdered by their 17-year-old son a week ago today, and then the boy took his own life. What's that family going through? You know, I could tell you story after story after story. Virtually everyone I meet experiences suffering at some level, some much greater than others. But one of the things that's just kind of elusive for us is the idea of suffering for our faith. And if we come back to the Bible in its context, Peter's writing to a group of people who said, I'm a follower of Jesus, and all sorts of bad things started happening to them. Now, this is just kind of like a happy little object lesson to all, but if you put your hand on a hot stove, what do you do immediately? Right? You should see me whenever I bite my tongue or my cheek while we're eating. You know, I almost concuss myself with a head recoil. We pull back from anything that causes us pain, physically, emotionally, spiritually. We recoil, right? And it's always interesting to me to hear stories about why people don't come to church, or why people have abandoned their faith. And almost always it comes back to some sort of disappointment with God. It comes back to some failed expectation. It's God didn't live up to his end of the bargain. But what's absolutely core at that whole discussion is a corrupt, and I use that word intentionally, a corrupt understanding of who God is. I was having a discussion with somebody once, and they were pointing out things to me, and I said, well, you know, the church has never suffered from a lack of bad theology. And there was even a comment this morning from our teacher in Sunday school about which God do you love? The God of the Bible, the God that we meet in the pages of Scripture, or the God that we've created in our own minds and in our culture? Because we have, you know, we have created a caricature of Jesus. We have created a picture that's very, very user-friendly. We like Jesus. We like Jesus holding children on his lap, don't we? That's a nice Jesus. He's a good guy. We like Jesus holding that lamb. That's a nice Jesus. Jesus is so nice. How nice is he? Even little lambs come to him to be cuddled. I wish we had more pictures of Jesus kicking over tables and hitting people in the temple. We don't talk about that. Really? What else don't you want to talk about? Jesus calling his disciples stupid? When did he call his disciples stupid? I would invite you to take some Greek courses. You know, our Bibles clean up a lot of language, but he basically in a couple of places says, what are you, dumb? Like he was kind of mean to them at times. He was really confrontational. You know, he broke social norms. He called people out. He said things to people that he shouldn't have said that. That made them uncomfortable. You know, that woman at the well, when he called her out for her promiscuity and her adultery, that's not nice. That's not nice, Jesus. Where's Jesus with the lamb? I want that Jesus. What about God, of whom Jesus is the second person of the Trinity, the triune God? You know, we have had this massive shift in our society away from, you know, the angry God of the Old Testament. We prefer the loving God of the New Testament. Same God. He hasn't changed. He never changes. Jesus is the same yesterday, today, and tomorrow. And Jesus is most resolutely God. And without getting into a big diatribe on the Trinity, suffice it to say, when you read of the God in the Old Testament that causes the deaths of tens of thousands of people, that's Jesus. Or the fact that we have a God who does not tolerate sin, a God who judges sin, a God who calls people out and says, I will deal with you, repent or else. We don't like that God. That's an angry God. I want the nice God. Give me the nice God. But you know what? We have created a caricature of God that inspires nothing. No fear, no reverence, no awe. He's just nice. He's nice. And if this nice God doesn't pony up and do what we tell him to, well then we'll teach him, won't we? We'll teach him. We won't come to church. Yeah? Stand before the judgment seat of God and see how righteous you are. Sorry, Katie. You should be used to that by now. But honestly, who do you think you're playing with? Who do you think you are dealing with? This is Almighty God who spoke all creation into being with a word, who sustains all things by his hand, who is sovereign over everything. Nothing draws breath but by the decreed will of God. The very reason you're here today is by the mercy of God. And you're going to start calling the shots? You're going to start telling them how it's going to be? You're going to start making the rules? Good luck with that. Good luck with that. But he's supposed to make my life better. No. His mandate is to make you holy so that you can stand in his presence. I thought he wanted me to be happy. I thought he wanted me to be rich. I thought he wanted me to experience perfect health. God doesn't give a rip about your bank account. What he cares about is your heart. And he will do whatever he needs to bring you into a right place with him, even if it means suffering. And verse 16 has this, in my mind, my quirky sense of humor, I find it rather comical. If you should suffer, you just told us for 3.5 chapters we're going to suffer. If you should suffer. Okay, well, what about it, Peter? If we should suffer. Are you ready for this? You note takers, get on your horses. This is going to be fast. Peter has 8 points. Ouch. You have 10 hymns. This is a bad day for this poor congregation, Dale. They're going to keep us separated. If you should suffer. You ready? Here we go. If you should suffer, don't be surprised. Verse 12. Dear friends, do not be surprised at the fiery ordeal that has come on you to test you as though something strange were happening to you. The word translated fiery ordeal probably means fire or burning. It has to do with the connotation of heating up metal so that it can be purified. The old sermon illustration is that the silversmith knows that the silver is pure when he can see his reflection in it. God will turn up the heat to drive away all the impurities, to get rid of the dross in your life, the spiritual dross in your life. Look at Malachi chapter 3, verses 2, 3, and 4. But who can endure the day of his coming? Who can stand when he appears? For he will be like a refiner's fire or a launderer's soap. He will sit as a refiner and purifier of silver. He will purify the Levites and refine them like gold and silver. Then the Lord will have men who bring offerings in righteousness, and the offerings of Judah and Jerusalem will be acceptable to the Lord as in the days gone by, as in former years. The trials that we endure serve a purpose. They rid us of all the taints and all that disqualifies. In short, they purify us and they make us holy. So, should you suffer, rejoice. Look at verse 13. But rejoice, inasmuch as you participate in the sufferings of Christ, so that you may be overjoyed when the glory is revealed. Instead of being thrown off balance by trials, Christians are to rejoice insofar as they share in the sufferings of Christ. Both verbs have a suggestion of continuation over time. So, insofar as you are sharing in Christ's suffering, keep on rejoicing. And I think it's amazing to think that increased sufferings seem only to increase the believer's joy in the Lord. But Scripture testifies that this is so. If you look at Acts chapter 5 and verse 17, the verses that follow, Peter and the apostles were jailed for preaching the gospel and performing miracles. In the middle of the night, an angel came and sprung them and sent them back to the temple to preach. They got rounded up again and brought before the Sanhedrin, which in the end decided to let them go, but not before a good flogging. Look at verses 40 and 41. They called the apostles in and had them flogged. Then they ordered them not to speak in the name of Jesus and let them go. The apostles left the Sanhedrin rejoicing because they had been counted worthy of suffering disgrace for the name of Jesus. Romans chapter 5, verses 2, 3, and 4. And we boast in the hope of the glory of the Lord, not only so, but we also glory in our sufferings because we know. What do we know? Not what we feel, what we know. Because we know that suffering produces perseverance, perseverance character, and character hope. Suffering has purpose. Sharing in the life of Christ includes the blessings and the burdens, celebration and sacrifice. You can't have one without the other. The joy we experience every spring is born from enduring a long winter. Amen? It's only November 6th and we're already thinking flowers in May, aren't we? But what gives us joy when spring shows up? The fact that we survived winter. You talk to people from Florida, you know what they miss? They miss winter. I thought they were cracked. Why do you miss winter? Because Because spring means nothing to them. It means nothing to them. Every day is just like every other day. It's incredible. But suffering has a purpose. It helps us appreciate. It helps us to see. We are to rejoice. Suffering is difficult. But it also establishes that you are blessed. Third point. If you should suffer, you're blessed. If you're insulted because of the name of Christ, you are blessed. For the spirit of glory of God rests on you. The Christian who suffers these kinds of abuses is uniquely blessed of God because the spirit of glory and of God rests on you. This refers to the indwelling presence of the Holy Spirit within those who are believers in Jesus Christ. And that word rest indicates that the Holy Spirit is within the believer continually to refresh and to strengthen. At any moment, we can draw on the Spirit of God, especially in moments of crisis and of suffering. God's Spirit is available to strengthen and refresh the believer. Now, something I was taught as a very young child by my mother, who at times was a notorious liar, was that old saying, "Sticks and stones may break my bones, but words will never hurt me." Over the years, I've discovered I'd much rather get hit with some sticks and stones, because words do hurt me. They sting me, they cut me, they drive their places into my heart where I get to think about them all night long. Words can build up, words can tear down. And people come and they insult us. And what's the number one hypocrite for, what's the number one insult for a Christian? I just told you. You're such a hypocrite. Yeah, we are. I remember going to the United Church in Kelowna, B.C., and Reverend Baldato was the pastor. United Church, you went to a United Church? Yes, I went to a United Church. I actually had some very good experiences in the United Church, and I can tell you about them sometime. But there we are in Kelowna at the United Church, and Reverend Baldato says, "Some people, they come to me and they say, we don't want to come to church. It's full of hypocrites." And I always say to them, "It's okay, we have room for two more." Aren't we all hypocrites at some level, in some way, about something? Aren't we? Don't we all kind of fall short of the glory of God? Isn't that why we come? To be reminded of the fact that as we confess, we are forgiven. It's a good thing. Let people insult you. You're blessed. Anything that we suffer for the sake of Christ is a privilege, not a penalty. When you're maligned for being a Christian, you are being elevated in the sight of God. Jesus himself says, "Blessed are you when people insult you, persecute you, and falsely say all kinds of evil against you because of me. Rejoice and be glad, because great is your reward in heaven, for in the same way they persecuted the prophets who were before you." And I think to that end, we should expect the insults. And remember, they insulted Jesus too. So don't drown in despair. You're in good company. But if you should suffer, let it be for doing good. Look at verse 15. If you suffer, it should not be as a murderer or a thief or any other kind of criminal or even as a meddler. Suffering for the name of Christ or for being a Christian is acceptable. Suffering for doing bad things is unacceptable and deserving. If you're going to suffer, let it be for doing good. There's something to be said about the power of a positive witness. Many of you might know the name Corrie Ten Boom, but the Ten Boom family, they weren't Jewish, but they stood up for the Jews as the Nazis began to persecute them as they conquered the Netherlands. And you know the story. Somebody ratted them out. They were caught, and they were actually sent to a concentration camp themselves where Corrie Ten Boom's sister died. If you're going to suffer, let it be for doing good. And there's all kinds of examples of people suffering for doing good. Abel offered a sacrifice better than his brothers, and what did he earn for that? A rock to the head. David did good, and he got chased down by Saul. David was a man after God's own heart, and look what his own son Absalom did to him. If you're not familiar with those stories, we'll lend you a Bible. Shoot, we'll give you a Bible. If you don't have a Bible, take a Bible. We're happy to give them away. If you're going to suffer, let it be for doing good. Take the higher road. Turn the other cheek. Do not repay evil with evil. Surrender your right to get even. Love like Jesus loved. love like Jesus loves. If you're going to suffer, let it be for the sake of the gospel. Look at verse 16. However, if you suffer as a Christian, the nickname Christian was originally used only by those hostile to Christianity. It was a slur. It was an insult. It was a bad thing to call somebody. It wasn't a compliment. Here it's parallel to the legal charges like murderer and thief. Early Roman descriptions of Nero's persecution used this title for Jesus' followers, first used in Antioch, I think around 40 AD, was it? First used in Antioch. You think about the Old Testament example where Daniel refused to stop praying and even in some convoluted shenanigans by the royal court, he ends up being thrown into a lion's den, but he's not going to stop praying. He's not going to stand up for his faith. We have the testimony of his friends before that and something about a fiery furnace you might remember, unless you're a fan of VeggieTales, and then you might know it more as Shadrach and Benny. But I digress. Again, don't use the gospel to incite abuse, but don't shrink from it either if it means denying your faith. Know whose team you're on. If you should suffer, do not be ashamed. The scripture says it there bluntly, do not be ashamed. Many wise men in Greek tradition pointed out that it was truly noble to suffer scorn for doing good. And in Greco-Roman society, this was a society that was obsessed with shame and honor. But to suffer for doing good, even though it didn't seem quite right, it was a bit of a counter-cultural insight. But it was so true, and all the more for the gospel. Do not be ashamed. I'm going to break the second rule of preaching sermon illustrations. I'm using a sports analogy, but a few years ago now, there was a quarterback played for the University of Florida, Tim Tebow. And I don't remember if he won the Heisman or not, but he was highly touted. He was drafted high in the draft. And he was very vocal about his faith. I read an article this week about, you know, why did people persecute Tim Tebow for his faith, but they didn't persecute the basketball player Steph Curry for his? And the article was supposed to be complimentary about Steph Curry. You know, Steph Curry's nice. He's just nice. You know, he doesn't make waves. He thanks God, and he's very positive. Tim Tebow stood up and said, you know, people are sinners and need to repent. Let me tell you, it didn't take long before the wheels started coming off for him. When he started quoting scripture, it wasn't John 3:16. It was Ephesians chapter 2. You know, he had no point telling the whole gospel. And we have truncated the gospel. We've cut it short. We like the Reader's Digest version of things. The gospel. Tell me about the gospel. God loves you. God loves you. And, you know, if you just believe in him, and, you know, if you feel like you go to church once in a while, and just be nice. it's not the gospel. It's got one snippet of the gospel. Here's the gospel. We're sinners. We are sinners. We have fallen short of the grace of God. We have transgressed God's holy decrees, his holy word. We have fallen short. And a holy God cannot tolerate the presence of sin. What is owed for all of humanity is eternal separation from God. But God, in his infinite mercy, has shown compassion, and according to a promise he made to somebody named Abraham, has been faithful to his covenant. And it has expanded. And some people think it was just narrow and just focused to a certain group of people. But if you read Genesis chapter 12, you'll see that God's promise was actually much broader than that and comes into fulfillment in the person of Jesus Christ, who makes us holy. You see, in the equation, the spiritual math of it all, sin equals death. But scriptures teach us in Leviticus, and it's reiterated in Hebrews, that in blood there is life. And in a sacrifice where blood is shed to make atonement for the sins committed, we experience something called the propitiation of God, where the wrath of God is appeased. And we can appropriate that grace through faith in Jesus Christ. And a faith that isn't just academic or theoretical, but one that plays itself out in the way we live our lives, in the way that we treat other people, in the way that we conduct ourselves. We don't do good to earn the love of God. We do good because we have experienced and received the love of God. It is the appropriate reaction. It is the appropriate reaction. Don't ever be ashamed for standing up and saying, I've been forgiven. Because I was a sinner. I am a sinner. But I exist by the grace and the mercy of God, and I have put my faith in Jesus Christ. And when I stand before that judgment seat of God, Katie, when I stand before the judgment seat of God, what is going to be my plea? What is going to be my, so why should I let you in? It ain't going to be because I'm going to say, well, you're nice. You're supposed to be nice. I will say because Jesus Christ died on a cross at Calvary and shed his blood as the atoning sacrifice for my sin, and I believe in Jesus. I believe he is the Son of God. I believe his blood has the power to save. I believe he died. I believe he has rose again, and I believe he ascended and sat at the right hand of God Almighty, and I believe that he will come back again to judge the quick and the dead. I believe that. With my whole being, I believe that. And let me tell you right now, up front and center, I'm a hypocrite. I fall short. I mess up. I'm not perfect. I don't claim to be. But you know what is perfect? The blood of Christ. You know what is the compassion of God, which is new every morning. The mercy of God, which is complete. And I don't take that for granted. I don't try to sin. I don't premeditate it. I just manage it all just quite nicely, thank you, because I have long ingrained established habits. But God is at work in me, and he's scrubbing that out, and he's turning up the temperature, and he's bringing the dross up to the top, and he's scraping it off, and none of that feels good. But he is very committed to making me holy, because he loves me. And I can accept that, or I can be ashamed of that. I can accept that, or I can reject that. Romans chapter 1 and verse 16. For I am not ashamed of the gospel, for it is the power of God for salvation to everyone who believes, to the Jew first and also to the Greek. Or how do you like 1 Corinthians chapter 1 and verse 18? For the word of the cross is folly, foolishness to those who are perishing, but to those of us who are being saved, it is the power of God. Or how about the words of Jesus Christ himself, who says in the Gospel of Mark, for whoever is ashamed of me and of my words in this adulterous and sinful generation, of him will the Son of Man also be ashamed when he comes into the glory of his Father with the holy angels. My friends, my brothers and sisters, don't ever be afraid to hold your heads up, push your shoulders back and declare, I am a child of God. Don't ever be ashamed. Be passionate and passionately praise God. If you should suffer, praise God. Look at the passage, but praise God that you bear that name. Verse 17, for it is time for judgment to begin with God's household. And if it begins with us, what will the outcome be for those who did not obey the gospel of God? That's in essence the last verse from the book of Proverbs that we read a little bit earlier. If it starts with us and this is how it ends, how much worse is it going to be for those who don't know God? Who don't know God? And if it is hard for the righteous to be saved, what will become of the ungodly and the sinner? You know that word there, praise God? In other translations, it's glorify God. In the English Standard Version, and pardon me, King James, it says glorify God. The NIV says praise God. It's the same Greek word that we get our word doxology from. It means to think or to suppose or be of an opinion. And what you think and suppose and have an opinion on is designed to solicit praise, to extol, magnify, celebrate, to honor and to do honor, to hold in honor, to make glorious, adorn with luster, clothe with splendor, to impart glory to something, render it excellent, to make renowned, render illustrious, to cause the dignity and worth of some person or thing to become manifest and acknowledged. That's what we do when we praise God. When you think back to the Exodus story and Egypt's chasing Israel and God parts the Red Sea, I mean, no disrespect to Charlton Heston, but I got to tell you, that scene in The Prince of Egypt, I know it's animated, but that was pretty fantastic, and like the big walls of water and the shark goes swimming through. Isn't that great stuff? And they march through and the Egyptian army thinks they're going to pursue and the waters collapse and they all drowned. What do you think that looked like? But you know what's fascinating there? In Exodus 15, we get our very first psalm where Moses breaks into song and he sings about the greatness, the magnificence of God. Wait a minute. Are you saying God killed like thousands and thousands of soldiers who were just doing what they were told? Yep, that's him. But he's supposed to be nice. Get him a lamb. Get him a child to hold. He's supposed to be nice. He's not supposed to kill people. If you are the enemy of God, you are picking a fight that you cannot and will not win. Get on the right side of the equation. If you should suffer, praise God. It's the appropriate response to his power. Hence Psalm 9, verses 1 and 2. I will give thanks to you, Lord, with all my heart. I will tell of all your wonderful deeds. I will be glad and rejoice in you. I will sing the praises of your name, O Most High. When you think about what awaits those who have rejected Jesus, all you can do is humbly express gratitude for the gift of grace and the salvation of your soul. Don't ever take that lightly. Don't ever take that for granted. If you should suffer, keep the faith. Look at verse 19. So then those who suffer according to God's will should commit themselves to their faithful Creator and continue to do good. There is reason and purpose in suffering, so endure it and experience the blessing of it. I remember trying to finish my doctorate. It was horrible. I ended up taking an entire year off. I was so frustrated. I was about to tank the whole thing. My faculty advisor told me that there's actually psychologists who their entire professional business is helping people finish their degrees. Because there's like a lot of us who go, forget it. Not like Dr. Shepherd, who finished his in a year and a half or something. But I'm more like Dr. Souter, who's just like, nah, don't want to do it. And then think, when, no, we got to do it. But Dr. Souter kind of pulled himself up by his bootstraps. I had an angry wife. I had an angry wife who inspired me and motivated me, who said, listen, Jack, you see how much money we spent on this? You see how much time you put into this already? You're finishing. I was like, okay. And I went back to my office, played one more game of some sort, and then finished that thing. I want to quote Wayne Grudem on this. This is from his commentary in 1 Peter. Talking about verse 19. In this one verse is summarized the teaching of the entire letter. Christians do not suffer accidentally or because of the irresistible forces of blind fate. Rather, they suffer according to God's will. While this may at first seem harsh, for it implies that at times it is God's will that we suffer, upon reflection, no better comfort in suffering can be found than this. It is God's good and perfect will, for therein lies the knowledge that there is a limit to the suffering, both in its intensity and in its duration, a limit set and maintained by the God who is our Creator, our Savior, our Sustainer, our Father. And therein also lies the knowledge that this suffering is only for our good, It is purifying us, drawing us closer to our Lord, and making us more like Him in our lives. In all of it, we are not alone, but we can depend on the care of a faithful Creator. We can rejoice in the fellowship of a Savior who has also suffered. We can exult in the constant presence of a Spirit of glory who delights to rest upon us. So if you should suffer, keep the faith. Keep your eyes on Jesus. For as Scripture says, therefore, since we are surrounded by such a great cloud of witnesses, let us throw off everything that hinders and the sin that so easily entangles, and let us run with perseverance the race marked out for us, fixing our eyes on Jesus, the pioneer and perfecter of faith. For the joy set before him, he endured the cross, scorning its shame, and sat down at the right hand of the throne of God. Consider him who endured such opposition from sinners, so that you will not grow weary and lose heart. If you should suffer, don't be surprised. If you should suffer, rejoice. If you should suffer, you're blessed. If you should suffer, let it be for doing good. If you should suffer, let it be for the sake of the gospel. If you should suffer, don't be ashamed. If you should suffer, praise God. And if you should suffer, and you will suffer, keep the faith. Queen Elizabeth had a powerful statement on the nature of war and the power of November 11th. She said, "In remembering the appalling suffering of war on both sides, we recognize how precious is the peace we have built in Europe since 1945. And I wonder if it isn't some small coincidence that the year where that peace was truly and resolutely broken was the same year that she went to be with the Lord in glory." Charles Stanley has said this, and with this we'll close. "Our Heavenly Father understands our disappointment, suffering, pain, fear, and doubt. He is always there to encourage our hearts and help us understand that He's sufficient for all of our needs. When I accepted this as an absolute truth in my life, I found that my worrying stopped." If you should suffer, and you will, let me pray for you. If you are new or visiting with us today, if you don't know who Jesus is, and you want to make Jesus Christ your Lord and Savior, I'd invite you to follow me in this prayer right now. O Holy God, you know me. You know my name. You know where I'm at right now with you. And I'm humbly asking, God, that you would forgive me of my sin, all of it. Forgive me and make me new. Lord, in this very moment, I renounce my sin. And though I know that I may still fall short, I am asking that you be patient with me, be gracious to me, and that you never take your love from me. For in this very moment, I commit myself to you and confess that I believe Jesus Christ is Lord, that he suffered and died and bled as the substitution for me, that he paid the penalty of my sin. And I would ask that when you look upon me, you would see me through Jesus and bestow unto me the righteousness of Christ. I believe that Jesus ascended from the grave and that he lives with you now and forever. And until that day comes, when either you call me home or you come in glory, that you would find me faithful to this prayer that I pray today. For I commit myself to you now and ask for these mercies in the name of Jesus. Amen. The conclusion of the service, I would ask that the elders would come and just take a spot on the front pews, and if you would like to come and just receive prayer or come and share with us that you have prayed to receive Christ, we will pray with you more, and we will provide you with a Bible and some information and ways that we can support you in this new decision in your life, this watershed moment in your life. But in the name of Jesus, I bless you all and wish you God's continued blessing through whatever trials God may bring into your way. If I could invite our worship team to come and close us this morning.
Wow, Pastor, thank you. Thank you. As we're going to stand and sing this. No, I'm going to have us. Yeah, we're going to stand, but not just yet. As we were practicing this song, I don't know if you guys noticed it, but it's kind of like a Jesus with the Lamb type of song, it seems. Jesus, sweet Jesus, etc., etc. And the music is kind of like almost frivolous. As you sing the song with us, you'll notice that. But don't let that fool you, because the depth of the message of the song indicates that Jesus is sweeter as I suffer more. As I walk along every day with Jesus, as I follow through, yesterday, today, and forever, he keeps me singing as I go. The difficult trials that I face, that trail that I'm walking on, the one song we said, things are difficult. But as we trust him instead of fighting him, he becomes sweeter. Because that's his promise. He holds us, he comforts us. You know the poem about the sand? There were two footprints walking along, the footprints, right? And then suddenly there's only one. And the person says, Jesus, what happened? You left me. No, that's when I picked you up. That's when I carried you. And if you've experienced Jesus, you know that's true. If you're fighting him right now because things are tough, stop fighting him. Embrace him. He wants to be that sweet Jesus that carries you through the difficulties because he's been there. He knows what it's all about. Let's stand and sing together. Think through the words as you sing. If you don't know the song, just listen to it.
There's within my heart a melody, Jesus whispers sweet and low. Fear not, I am with thee, peace be still, in all of love's ebb and flow. Jesus, 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 sweetest name I know, fills my every longing, keeps me singing as I go. All my life was wrecked by sin and strife, discord filled my heart with pain. Jesus swept across the broken strings, stirred the slumbering chords again. Jesus,
Jesus, Jesus, Jesus, sweetest name I know. Fills my every longing, keeps me singing as I go. Feasting on the riches of His grace, resting neath the sheltering wing, always looking on His smiling face, that is why I shout and sing. Jesus, 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 sweetest name I know, fills my every longing, keeps me singing as I go. Though sometimes He leads through waters deep, trials fall across the way. Though sometimes the path seems rough and steep, see His footprints all the way. Jesus, 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 sweetest name I know. Every longing keeps me singing as I go. Soon He's coming back to welcome me, far beyond the starry sky. I shall wing my flight to worlds unknown, I shall be with Him on high. Jesus, 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 sweetest name I know.
Thank you.
I'd like to invite everyone to stay for coffee and refreshments downstairs following the service. I was going to say something else, Jonathan. Do you remember what it was?
I do not.
Yeah, it's gone too. Grab a shoebox on your way out. Thank you, Miranda. If you've prayed to receive Christ today as your Lord and Savior, would you please share it with somebody before the sun sets tonight? And now may the God of peace, who through the blood of the eternal covenant brought back from the dead our Lord Jesus, that great shepherd of the sheep, equip you with everything for doing His will, and may He work in us what is pleasing to Him through Jesus Christ, to whom be glory forever and ever. Amen. Praise God, from whom all blessings flow. Praise Him, all creatures here below. Praise Him above, ye heavens.